Okay, good morning, and welcome to the first ever East Meets West Forum on a Nuclear-Free Massachusetts. But before we begin today's presentation, I'd like to thank the studios of GCTV here, and in particular, Scott McPherson and Michael Hainish of Free Lunch Films for making this event possible by doing the videotaping and facilitating the entire program. It's a really interesting date to pick to talk about the dangers of nuclear power, as it's the 70th anniversary of the dropping of the atomic bomb on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, ushering in what's called the atomic age. And there was an awful lot of hard sell after the dropping of those bombs to promote the peaceful atom, the safe and peaceful atom. And I see in the audience there are many of us who remember well the little lightning bolt figure with the light bulb head named Reddy Kilowatt, who promoted nuclear power plants as safe, clean, and too cheap to meter. Well, are they really? We're going to discuss nuclear power today on this very important date. I'd like to outline the format. Each panelist will be speaking for approximately 8 minutes or so, and then there would be some general discussion. And members of the audience who wish to ask questions or state concerns, would you please come up to the microphone on my right, your left, and address the panel, and they will address your questions or concerns if possible. Okay, I'd like to introduce the panel at this time. And we'll start off with our guests from the East Coast. They came all the way from the East Coast. And our panel consists of, let's see, I got to look at my notes here. We have all the way down at the end there, Arlene Williamson. And Arlene is from Mashpee, Massachusetts. And she is on the Executive Steering Committee of the Pilgrim Coalition. The Pilgrim Coalition, you can get more information about them on their website, which is thepilgrimcoalition.org. I've perused this website, and it's very informative about the Pilgrim Nuclear Power Plant down there in Plymouth, Massachusetts. Arlene became aware of the problems with nuclear power after the Fukushima incident, which we're all living with the consequences of at this moment, at least on the Pacific coast, and was prompted by that catastrophe to take a path of activism. Our next guest from the East Coast is Diane Turco, and Diane is from the town of Harwich, Massachusetts, and she was one of the co-founders of Cape Downwinders and also Mass Downwinders. These are folks in the Cape Cod region. And their website is downwinders.org for more information. And she is a former special education teacher, retired, who became active in the 1980s when she became concerned about the safety record and the hazards of nuclear power in the nearby, well, it's not near to Harwich necessarily, it's across the bay, but nonetheless, the effects of the Pilgrim Nuclear Power Plant and the possibilities of a catastrophe on Cape Cod. She has acted legislatively and locally and on the streets for many years, educating the public, and I'd like you to welcome them folks, our visitors from the East. And on the West, we'll begin with Deb Katz. Deb is the executive director of the Citizens Awareness Network, better known as CAN. She has been a longtime nuke buster here in Western Massachusetts and has worked tirelessly for the closing of nuclear power plants, not only here in New England, but elsewhere. And she's been a very vocal and educating person and a treasure to work with. Okay, we have Claire Chang, who is sitting next to me. Claire is a co-owner of the Solar Store of Greenfield, Massachusetts, and also a member of the board of directors of the Citizens Awareness Network. And she has worked legislatively to change and promote alternative energy sources, sustainable energy sources, and has worked very hard doing this and has a modicum of success, although I know that she's personally disappointed in the recent legislation that has passed here in Massachusetts. Eh?
It hasn't passed yet.
Okay. And we have Tim Judson, the other male on the...
I was going to say the only male.
What am I? Well, Tim Judson is the president of the Citizens Awareness Network and the executive director of the NIRS, which is the Nuclear Information Resource Service. And that is an organization that disseminates information on the status of nukes nationwide and also on grassroots organizing, a very important organization, which can be very helpful to many of the growing nuclear opponents in the United States. So each panelist will have approximately 8 minutes or so to give an overview, a historical overview or a local overview of not only their organization, but the fights and the adversity that may lie ahead, and advocating for, cooperation between the other nuclear groups in New England. They will speak, and as I say, any persons that have questions or queries, please step to the microphone to my right, your left, and address them to the board. So thank you for coming, and we'll begin. I guess they flipped the coin over there, and Arlene Williamson is going to speak first, and she is from Pilgrim Coalition, and she will speak to their organization and to you.
Thank you very much. Thank you all for coming. My name is Arlene Williamson. I'm an executive steering member of Pilgrim Coalition, and we are a group advocating for public health and safety and environmental protection from the risks posed by the Pilgrim Nuclear Power Station in Plymouth, Massachusetts. Our coalition consists of over 28 member groups, and a lot of those groups are very active in pursuing their own strategies to with things that are important to them in as far as keeping a watchful eye on Pilgrim, bringing attention to the problems at Pilgrim, and also, you know, very active with filing 2.206 petitions with the NRC about issues and problems that are at that plant. And I'll just mention a few of our more active members. I mean, we have Toxics Action, we have Citizens Awareness, we have Clean Water Action, many, many groups. But I'm going to mention a few that are in and around the area that are doing some terrific work. One of them is Cape Cod Baywatch. And a lot of you may know of Mary Lampert, who has been working on this cause forever. She's devoted. She's just tirelessly researching different issues related to Pilgrim. She's concerned with radioactive waste, emissions. She also serves on the Duxbury Nuclear Advisory Committee. She's very active in attending town meetings, Nuclear Matters Committee's meetings, and really, really being a watchdog for Pilgrim, a perfect name for her. And right now, she's very active in strategy planning for some great legislation that's coming out in some bills that are going to be introduced in the near future that deal with Pilgrim expanding emergency planning zones, a possibility of imposing a fee on spent fuel, different things that she is going to be taking a big stand and lead on. She also wants to, because Vermont has been so instrumental in taking a lead ahead of us, we are also, you know, trying to prepare at some point for decommissioning when it does come. And, you know, you guys are dealing with a whole new set of problems after you close it. So she's been just great. The other group that's really active now is Cape Cod Baywatch and Jones River Water Association. They have just merged together. But basically what they're dealing with is the effects of Cape Cod, what's happening to Cape Cod Bay as far as their once through cooling system. They're killing of fish and plankton from the intake screens, from all the fish that in plankton and marine life that is killed and impinged on screens when the water of 500 million gallons of water sucked in every day, heated at a higher temperature, and then expelled out into Cape Cod Bay. So it sort of really kind of has really altered the marine life and the ecosystem in Cape Cod Bay. Along with that is expelling, you know, different kind of chemicals into the bay from backwashing the cooling system. And one of the biggest things they're working right now on, which is hard to believe, but Entergy is operating Pilgrim Nuclear Station with an expired clean water permit, and it's expired 19 years ago. So where in God's name do you be able to put pollution into a water source and have actually no permit to do so? But they get away with this stuff. So right now that's one of the things. And Meg is actually going to be, has a video. I don't know if you're going to be able to, she had taped the three actions she's working on. That's one, the expired permit. The other one is also a problem is dry quart cask storage in Plymouth. And what they've done is they've built a dry cask storage site. For the first time, they did dry cask storage a few months ago. And they built it 125 feet offshore at a very vulnerable sea level. And, you know, we've seen what storms can do in the last few years with Hurricane Sandy and Irene. And it's real vulnerable to sea level rise, climate change and sea level rise, warming waters, incredible storm surges from some of the horrific nor'easters that we're getting. And so they're dealing with a lot of those issues. And one is that Entergy, again, was able to build this dry cask storage behind closed walls without a special permit in a location that doesn't make sense to anybody because it's in an area that is vulnerable to flooding. And there's lawsuits that they're handling. She's an environmental lawyer and has a spear team of volunteer lawyers who are taking those challenges on. So that basically covers them. The other new group who has just started probably about 2 years ago was spearheaded by an RN in the area who lives directly near Plymouth, and it was called Concerned Neighbors of Pilgrim. And their main concern is all the nuclear waste that's being stored on top of the reactor at Pilgrim. Designed to hold 880 assemblies, it now holds over 3,200. I think it's even more that now. And they're very concerned. If, for God forbid, it lost cooling, it was hit by a terrorist attack, it was, Martha Coakley, the former Attorney General, did a study that if it was compromised, it would result in $488 billion in damages, 24 latent cancers, and, you know, it would affect most of the people that live in a very big proximity around there who will probably never be able to go back to their homes, God forbid something happened. So these are really serious issues, and we have some great groups within our coalition. They all do something, but these are the ones who really spearhead the biggest. The next one is Cape Downwinders, who have been incredible in organizing Cape Cod and bringing awareness to the public on the proximity, the dangers, the risks that are posed by this plant. And because they live in such a unique geographical area, I don't know if any of you have been to Cape Cod, but in the summertime, it's almost impossible to get off Cape Cod on certain days. And if there was an accident, complete panic and pandemonium would set in where it would be a disaster. And I'll let Diane speak more about Cape Downwinders, but they've done some incredible work in organizing campaigns, putting on non-binding referendums where the Cape Cod people get it. They really get it. It's just a matter of now letting the host town of Plymouth get it. And that's the struggle we're having right now. So I'll let Diane speak now, and thank you very much.
Well, thank you for your presentation. It was very informative, and we'll hear from Diane.
All right. I'm Diane Turco with Cape Town Winders. Cape Town Winders began actually in the late 80s, early 90s, when Pilgrim was shut down for 2 years because of so many issues, and when it was restarted, it was restarted over the opposition of every elected official in the state, our governor, and even FEMA rejected the restart because of public safety. So that jumped me on board. It's like, how can all these elected officials say we're not safe, and then the NRC overrides them all, and the reactors started operating at our risk. So Cape Town Winders is a group of citizens on the Cape who are working to close the Pilgrim nuclear reactor. You know, whether you're for or against nuclear power, public safety should be a concern for all. So we felt that public safety would be a great umbrella to work through, because everybody agrees public safety comes first. So we work on actually three prongs: investigating, educating, and agitating. So the first one is investigating. So we looked into what were the plans for Cape Codders, and we found that, in fact, the plans for Cape Cod was to close the Sagamore Bridge and close the Bourne Bridge if it was going to be impeding escapees from Plymouth, which of course it would, and that we would just be on the Cape and exposed. And we were outraged that we were considered an expendable population to the corporate profits of Entergy. And that's where it all started. So we looked at the MEMA plans, we talked to our elected officials, and we found that, yes, MEMA, that the NRC is not regulating the industry and not regulating Entergy, and that the state of Massachusetts is complicit.
Would you just say what MEMA is?
Massachusetts Emergency Management Agency, yes, yes. And they're responsible for developing the plans off-site. And that's one of our big targets, is to have MEMA reject the plans that won't provide for the public protection. And that's working up to the state level, to the governor's office. So that we investigate in a lot of our research. We do a lot of research. Bill Maher's done a lot of research on what's happening around the reactor with the spent fuel site. But we do our research. And then we go, the next pillar is educating people. You know, an informed democracy makes responsible decisions. And Thomas Jefferson got that right. So what we do is we have an educational program that goes around. We go around the state, actually. We've talked to Rotary Clubs, League of Women Voters Clubs, citizen groups, library groups, educating them with our program, Pilgrim, a Threat to Us All. Because it's not just about Cape Cod, but it's really all of us. So we do educational programs. We also do political programs. We have sponsored legislation. Not sponsored legislation. We've sponsored non-binding referendum questions on the ballot. And in 2012, we had a question on all Cape Town ballots at town meetings, where we asked the governor to write to the Nuclear Regulatory Commission and demand that they uphold their mandate for public safety and revoke the operating license of Pilgrim. It passed in all towns. All towns, and on Martha's Vineyard too. So we were using the voters and our responsibility as citizens to push the issue to the governor. In fact, we had to have a rally a year later. Governor Patrick hadn't written that letter, and we ended up having a big rally called Wake Up Governor in the State House, right in the Gardner Auditorium, where hundreds of Cape Codders filled the auditorium, and we all spoke for 2.5 hours and marched up to his office and said, you need to write that letter. We were told, well, we'll have a meeting next week. No, we don't want a meeting. We want a letter. We want it now. We determined we weren't going to leave the office, and he wrote the letter. And when he wrote that letter, it changed the attitude of elected officials and public safety officials across the state. We also worked with the Barnesville County Emergency Planning Committee and talked to them about Pilgrim. And when we started, they were very skeptical about what we were saying. They thought we were just anti-nuclear activists as opposed to informed citizens. Well, 3 years later, they now have a brochure about how to protect yourself, but there is no plan for Cape Cod. The other thing that we've done is agitation. So agitation is a really important thing in a democracy. We really have to be responsible to that. We get out in the streets. We have demonstrations every Labor Day and Memorial Day, a No Escape from the Cape rally. We just recently marched from Plymouth to Boston State House in 4 days and had Governor Dukakis put the link from 1988 when he said we can't escape. I mean, there's no safety for people from this Pilgrim reactor. It needs to be shut down. And we're trying to link that to Governor Baker today because it's still the same situation. So that's work that we've done. We've had speakers. We've had Nano Khan. We've hosted Nano Khan, the former Prime Minister of Japan, along with the former chair of the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, Gregory Yasko, who voted against the relicensing of Pilgrim. We've had Peter Bradford, Arne Gunderson, Dr. Ed Lyman from the Union of Concerned Scientists, Dr. Helen Caldicott has spoken for us many times. So we're pulling in international folks to speak on the dangers of Pilgrim right in our backyard. So that's part of the educational efforts that we've done, educational and agitation. So right now what we're working on is there are bills at the State House. There are three bills that call to expand the emergency planning zone. And the reason we're doing that is we know we can't be protected. But if we can inform other people that you are also in an emergency planning zone, the 50-mile ingestion pathway zone includes Plymouth and Boston. I mean, people don't even know. 2 years ago when we testified, we asked the Senate committee and the House committee, do you folks know you're in an emergency planning zone? And no one knew. So again, too, that's part of the education. If we can get these bills passed, they will be in an official plume exposure, which also involves evacuation. That's one of our goals. The other two bills are to increase the fee on the spent fuel that will cost Entergy a lot of money, and the other is decommissioning funds because we see what's happening in Vermont. So we're very excited to be connecting with the West. The East and the West finally meet, yes. And you know we're very pleased that citizens now are uniting to make closing Pilgrim a reality. That's exactly what we need to do because we are all downwinders. Thank you.
Thank you for your presentation. Before we leave the East Coast, folks, I'd like to ask a question of a little bit of history on the Pilgrim plant. How old is this plant, and what mishaps has it had that have prompted you folks to become activists?
Well, I'll answer the easy one, 43 years, Diane, if you want to.
Okay.
The one in million.
Oh,
other.
Well, I'll tell you what's happening right now. Right now, it's one of the worst operating reactors in the country. During Storm Juno, the switchyard failed once again. The Nuclear Regulatory Commission, in 2013, the switchyard failed. Scram, right? NRC comes in and says, we're going to oversee you for another year because of this. You had more shutdowns than any reactor in the country. A year later, when the NRC investigated their own oversight, Entergy failed again. Failure, failure. It's a failed reactor with failed oversight run by a failed corporation. That's what Pilgrim is. So right now, it's one of the worst. They failed their, they've just failed so many times that it's an imminent threat because of that. Safety systems fail. And actually, the last storm scram, Dr. David Lockbaum from the Union of Concerned Scientists said it was a near miss. And they knew about it. That's the problem, is in the report, Entergy did not complete the corrective action plan. So they aren't spending money to make the repairs that they need to do. So.
Thank you for that information.
Okay. All right.
I guess we'll move along right in order here. And
no. We're going to go in last.
Okay. I guess the executive director has said that to make her last, so we will. Tim, would you like to speak next, or Claire?
Sure, I can go next.
Okay. Jim Judson.
So my name's Tim Judson. As Peter mentioned, I'm the president of the board of Citizens Awareness Network, have been for several years. I've actually worked with CAN since 1998, and have been very involved in the work that CAN has done to close the Vermont Yankee reactor throughout that time. And that was a major victory for us when the plant shut in December. And Vermont Yankee, as some of you may know, is owned by Entergy, which is the same company that owns Pilgrim. And so there's a very close connection between the problems that have been occurring at Pilgrim and the same problems that forced Vermont Yankee to close, which is essentially that these reactors are no longer profitable to run. And you're seeing this company operating these reactors you know, essentially on a shoestring budget and cutting costs on the very sort of maintenance issues that are now coming to the fore with these failures at Pilgrim. Now, I think to Peter's question about the danger that Pilgrim poses, since I also work for the Nuclear Information and Resource Service, which is sort of the national hub of the grassroots anti-nuclear movement. And so we come to this work, through working with grassroots groups like CAN, Pilgrim Watch, and the Pilgrim Coalition, across the country. And, to put the danger of Pilgrim in perspective, for the entire state of Massachusetts and the rest of New England, Pilgrim is probably the closest sort of situation in the U.S. to the Fukushima plant in Japan. Pilgrim is rated currently the second most likely reactor in the country to suffer a nuclear accident as a result of an earthquake. And that's partly because it is situated on a coastal area very close to sea level, in an area that has much more seismic activity than was known when the plant was built. And so people often think of the reactors on the West Coast, Diablo Canyon, San Onofre, that are near the San Andreas fault line, that people assume that those plants would be most at risk of an accident. Whereas in fact, Pilgrim is more at risk than those reactors because it was never built to withstand the type of seismic activity that could occur. And Pilgrim is also the exact same design, the exact same faulty design as the reactors at Fukushima that blew up. And so what we have, in eastern Massachusetts on the coast is essentially a twin of the Fukushima plant. And that should put in perspective the kind of disaster that Massachusetts is facing with the continued operation of this plant, especially under the conditions in which Entergy is operating it. But I guess I was asked to sort of provide some national perspective on these things.
Well, it's clear.
And one thing I'll start with, which I'll come back to in a little bit, is that we just had a major victory this week with the Obama administration releasing the final version of its new power plant regulation, the Clean Power Plan. And the reason why this is so important, even though it mostly relates to fossil fuel power plants and climate change, is that EPA did something incredibly historic and significant in this final draft of the regulation, which is that they actually took nuclear power out of the Clean Power Plan. So it is a now official U.S. government policy that nuclear power is not a viable climate solution. And this has tremendous implications for not just nuclear power nationally, but also how we close uneconomical, dangerous reactors like Pilgrim going forward. And so I'll come back to that in a minute. But to put that in context, what's happening in the nuclear industry nationally right now is essentially an economic phase out of nuclear power. The industry is in tremendous economic trouble. And the closure of Vermont Yankee was one of the first sort of symptoms of that. In 2013, there were 5 reactor closures announced across the country. This was the most reactor closures in any single year in U.S. history. And then for the first time, any reactors had closed in over 15 years. And what that sort of has brought about is an increasing awareness that nuclear power is actually no longer a viable industry going forward in the long term. And what we're seeing is that there are sort of kind of canaries in the reactors that are canaries in the coal mine, where their operating costs, now that they're aging at 43 years, their operating costs are skyrocketing because the cost of maintaining these old reactors is becoming close to how expensive they were to build originally, which is to say cost prohibitive. Which means that, especially in an era where not just because of natural gas, but because states like Massachusetts have gotten their act together in terms of energy efficiency, where renewable energy, the cost of renewable energy is falling, and the rate at which renewable energy is being put on the grid is astronomical, and causing electricity prices to go down at the same time that the cost of operating these old nuclear plants is going up. So the nuclear industry right now has essentially launched what we're calling a nuclear war on renewable energy. They are trying to basically stop renewable energy dead in its tracks. And they're doing this in a bunch of different ways. They've been lobbying in Congress for several years very, very hard to kill the federal incentives for renewable energy, like the wind production tax credit, which, you know, has basically been in a fight for its life every year for the past several years. They're going to be campaigning to stop the incentives for solar power across the country. And then they're engaged in fights at the state and local level against things like renewable energy standards, against net metering for solar, all these things that actually enable renewable energy to take hold. They're trying to put a block on, and then trying to basically sell nuclear power after they've proven or tried to prove that, you know, renewable energy just isn't economically viable. Then they're coming back and asking for subsidies for nuclear power plants as the only viable climate solution. Well, the EPA just put an end to that argument. Now states could still decide to subsidize nuclear power because the industry is so powerful and has so much influence, but they're not going to be able to do it and argue that they're doing it because we need to for global warming. And that's incredibly important because what the EPA also just said is that the reason that you shouldn't give credit to existing nuclear power plants under the climate change policies is because they can't reduce emissions, and that what's important is reducing emissions. And because you can't build new nuclear power plants and cost effectively, that what's really left is renewable energy, and renewable energy can replace nuclear power plants just like it can replace coal plants and it can replace natural gas plants. And so what the EPA has essentially said is that we should be looking at with uneconomical power plants like Pilgrim that can't compete in the markets anymore, that those should be allowed to close, and that we can replace that energy with renewable energy. And in fact, what we're looking to on a national basis is being able to actually support climate change policies as the anti-nuclear movement to ensure that nuclear power plants are replaced with renewable energy, and that if we do this proactively, this can actually continue to put even more and more economic pressure on these uneconomical plants to retire, because the amazing thing is that as you build out solar power, as you build out wind power, what it actually does is it causes energy prices to go down even further. And this is better for consumers, this is better for businesses, this is better for the economy because we're growing new industries at a very large scale when you talk about replacing nuclear power plants with renewables. That this is actually a way to both accelerate our transition into a carbon-free economy and accelerate the closure of uneconomical, dangerous old nuclear power plants like Pilgrim. And so that's, I think, sort of the pivotal moment that Massachusetts is at right now, is to be able to make a choice, just like Vermont just made a choice in opting to close Vermont Yankee, that Massachusetts is in a position right now to go nuclear free and to do it in a way that's actually going to accelerate the transition to a carbon-free economy as well.
Thank you for that presentation, Tim. I guess we'll move on now to Claire Chang. Take it away.
So I'll follow up on the renewable energy, and in particularly in Massachusetts. So Deval Patrick, the governor, in 2008 passed or signed into law a bill called the Global Warming Solutions Act, and that allowed Massachusetts to participate with a number of other states in New England in developing the Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative, REGI, and also setting an RPS, a Renewable Portfolio Standard. It's only 1% right now. It really needs to go to 2 or 2.5, maybe even 3%. That would be wonderful. And also in the same year, 2008, he also passed the Green Communities Act, which enabled a number of towns and municipalities in Massachusetts to get on board through a grant process to reduce their own municipal energy use by 20% in 5 years. And that, I don't have the numbers off the top of my head, but there are a number of towns, particularly out in this area in western Massachusetts, who have signed up for the Green Communities Act and have aggressively moved to reduce through energy efficiency. I think it's mostly through energy efficiency and some renewable projects. But also part of the Green Communities Act allowed for 400 megawatts of electricity to be generated by solar power by 2020. At the time when he came up with this 400 megawatts, this was a huge goal. Everybody was like, this will be wonderful. Well, we met the 400 megawatts in 2 years. So then everybody went, what are we going to do now? So they then started a new program saying that we needed to get to 1,600 megawatts. Now, that may sound like a big number to you, and it is kind of a big number. Right now, Massachusetts is a little over 800 megawatts of installed solar PV power. So 1,600 would be double that. But the peak load in Massachusetts is about 26,000 megawatts. Mm. So on the sunniest day in August, when everybody's got their air conditioners running, it's 95 degrees for the fifth day in a row. That's what that would represent. So we don't need to meet that level every day. More often, we're down in the 1,500s, 18, maybe a little around 200. 20,000. But so 1,600 megawatts is a very small number compared to the total demand for electricity in the state of Massachusetts. So we have a long way to go, and we need to push that goal out. Unfortunately, Governor Baker just announced Thursday his proposal for legislation for solar in the state. Right now, we're at a cap. We have a net metering cap, which only allows a certain amount of solar to be installed, and it's 4% for private installations and 5% for municipal town installations. And that percentage is based on that historic cap. So let's say the 26,000, it's a percentage of that is what we're allowed. In National Grid territory, we met that cap in March. So in 171 towns in the state of Massachusetts, there is no solar PV going up. That's above, there's very small solar, 10 kilowatts and under on single phase and 25 kilowatts and under on three phase are exempt from the cap. So most of the small residential, small commercial sites are still going through. And any sites that are only behind the meter, so all the power is used behind the utility meter and never goes out onto the grid, those are still being developed. But any sites where they need to have the electricity net metered so that during the day when it's nice and sunny, the electricity just goes out onto the grid, and at night when we don't have any sun, the facility can bring electricity back in. That's the net metering concept. Now, because that cap is met and been exceeded or met in 171 towns, those towns can't put new PV up to take advantage of that net metering structure since March. So there is a wait list. This wait list already has 48 megawatts of projects waiting to go online. The little eensy-beensy raise that Governor Baker has recommended, which goes from 9 overall to, 13% overall, will get us to the end of this year. It's just so measly. I just can't express how poor it is. Well, the reason why I need to emphasize this is because the media is pushing it as, oh, we're raising the net metering cap, glory be, we're going to all just be fine. Well, that is not the case. And it's just infuriating how either stupid the media is, which is probably true, or how bought they've gone into whatever Governor Baker or the Associated Industries of Massachusetts or the utilities. The Kool-Aid is very strong. And we want to believe positively. We're all human beings. We want to see the bright side of everything. So in Baker's proposed legislation, there is two bright side pieces, which is that he has grandfathered all current existing systems in their current rate structures, current net metering rules, current incentives. So anyone who has a system up running now, you won't lose those advantages for 20 years. So that's good. But everything else in that bill is horrible. One other key thing is instead of the 1,600 megawatts being AC, he's changed it to DC. Hmm. That's an automatic 23% decrease in the amount of power that will go out. Because when you convert from DC to AC, there's a loss of efficiency there. So Most people don't understand this and will think, well, that's no big deal. He just changed from A to D. Everybody knows the band AC/DC. So, you know, what's the big deal? But it's actually a huge, substantial difference in how much power will be available for anyone in the Commonwealth to take advantage of. And there's a number of other things that are really bad in it, which I won't go into, because what we really need to emphasize is the good things. So what we need is to raise the net metering caps. The net metering caps are strictly an artificial construct. There's no technical reason for them to exist. It's merely for the utilities and the legislature to be able to manipulate the market. Now, clearly, in 2008 till up to about 2012, the marketplace for solar PV was infants, very beginning, early adopters, very expensive, not very many people interested. It was still something, you know, futuristic. After 2012, when the prices basically dropped in half, everybody realized, wait a minute, I can do this. I can get a payback on my system in just 6 or 7 years, and then I get free electricity afterwards. Why am I waiting to do this? So for people who have roofs that face south or west, who have no trees, who have no chimneys, no shading issues, it's the perfect solution for energy independence, creating a distributed generation grid, for providing for the future, for making a statement to doing carbon-free energy generation. There's a number of reasons why everyone should be doing this. Now, that can only apply to about 20 to 25% of the population, though, because everybody else rents, has low income, doesn't have a roof that faces south, has trees that are in the way that belong to their neighbors, have a slate roof, have any of a number of other issues. So 75 to 80% of the population are excluded from personal, private ownership. Why should they be excluded from this opportunity? They should be included into this whole big picture. And there are ways through community shared solar, through any of a number of other initiatives. But those initiatives are highly dependent on what's called virtual net metering. So for the house that has a meter and you net meter to the grid, you're counting forwards and backwards. Virtual net metering allows a remotely sited facility to count towards your electric bill, whatever amount you've contributed towards, some percentage. The rate at which you're compensated for is what's determined through virtual net metering. Right now, it's retail, nearly retail, which is good. What you pay to the utility for your electricity is what you would get from the remote site. What Governor Baker, what the utilities have been suggesting for years is that we should cut that in half. That it should not be retail. It should only be wholesale. And we can't allow this to happen because it's going to eliminate a huge segment of the population from participating in this revolution. And actually, that's what the utilities want. They want their share, which is basically 100% of the profits. And they can't imagine, as Jigar Shaw says, how to make new money. There are plenty of opportunities for the utilities to step into this game, like Green Mountain Power in Vermont. They are phenomenal. They have not, since Vermont Yankee, the fight to shut it down has been, you know, been really boiled up to the surface, and Vermont Yankee shut down. Green Mountain Power has really stepped to the forefront and said, okay, we're going to meet this whole revolution head on and embrace it and figure out how to make our utility model work with this new paradigm. And they are doing energy storage, they're doing energy efficiency, they're helping people put heat pumps in their houses, they're helping create microgrids, they're helping envision how we could make this work. They don't know what the, you know, end goal is, they don't know what it's going to look like, but they're moving in that direction. Whereas all these other utilities are dragging their feet, clawing, and just acting like, two-year-old toddlers. It's really awful. They need to just grow up and figure out how they can make money. There's plenty of opportunities. Energy efficiency, energy storage are two big areas where they can actually profit. And we need to somehow open their eyes and make this a possibility for them. So what I need you to do is to call Governor Baker and tell him that his bill that he introduced on Thursday, August 7th, was not good enough. And the interesting thing is that clearly the language in there indicates that he has heard and from people, because he's inserted words that we've used, but he's put them inappropriately and not answered them correctly and supported them wholly. Oops, sorry. So what we need is Governor Baker to understand that we're not just calling him on a lark because we happen to have our cell phones out and we called his number. We are really interested in making this happen and that we need him to really step up and pay attention. This is not just a flyby issue. This is something that all of us know that for our lifetimes and for our children and grandchildren, this is something that we have to do. And we can't sit back.
What do you want them to ask him to do?
We want him to lift the net metering caps at least till the end of 2016, because the federal tax credit ends, the 30% tax credit ends at the currently at the end of 2016. We have no idea what will happen in 2017, but the least he could do is make it so that Massachusetts has the opportunity to take advantage of this 30% tax credit. It's been calculated that we, right now, because of the net metering cap limit, we are losing $3 million a day on projects that are not being built. And $1 million of that is federal tax credits that are not coming back to the state. How can you leave $1 million on the table every day? This is absurd. So the minimum he needs to do is to lift the net metering caps. Then we should be talking about energy storage, and we also need to raise the RPS to 2.5%, and we also need to look more forward to 20% renewables by 2025. That seems like a huge number to us now. Hawaii is at 30% already. Germany is at over 50%. A number of other countries have established goals that are much higher than that by 2030. This is not pie in the sky. This is not new technology. This is all off the shelf. We could do it today if we just had the political will. The money is already there. The investors are standing in line ready to write the checks. But if we don't have the legislation, if we don't have the governor on board, we can't get this done in Massachusetts, and we desperately need to get it done in Massachusetts. If Massachusetts can't do it, the rest of the states won't do it. California and Massachusetts are in the forefront, and we have to step forward and continue leading. We can't step back and say, oh, well, we did a really good job, now we're done. It can't happen. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Claire, for that very succinct and accurate portrayal of what's going down and what needs to be done and how doable it is. Very nice presentation. And I guess last but not least is our executive director over there.
Yes. So I'm Deb Katz.
Deb.
And I'm sitting at an impossible table that's going to drive me crazy talking from, because I won't sit still. So I'm going to apologize in advance that it won't record so great because I'd rather walk around. So I'll give a little background on Citizens Awareness Network. CAN is a grassroots group. We began in Western Massachusetts with the issues around the Yankee Row Reactor, which is in Row, Massachusetts. It's a town I live in. I live 4.5 miles from Yankee Row, which is a high-level nuclear waste dump, and I live, in fact, 16 miles from Vermont Yankee, which is becoming a high-level waste dump. It's a low-level waste dump now as well. Neither are operating. I used to actually make jokes about living in the meltdown zone, and it didn't seem like such a big deal to me until there were issues that were raised about Yankee Row and the potential that it could shatter like glass in an accident. We had 1,000 people show up for a hearing with the NRC, and dog and pony shows that were done by the corporation, which was Yankee Atomic. We, at that point, were talking about how concerned we were, and the corporation was going around basically saying we were suffering from nuclear hysteria, and if we just started worshiping our refrigerators again, everything would be okay. And a guy got up and he said, hey, you know, that Row reactor, it's on stilts, and in a meltdown, wouldn't it fall over and contaminate the Deerfield River? And the chemist got up from Yankee Atomic, who is never allowed to get up again, and he said, well, hell, we've been dumping in your river for 31 years. What's the difference? And yes, there was this kind of silence. And people were shocked because, of course, we all felt the EPA did a job, the NRC did a job. There was all of this backup. How could this be happening? This isn't America. This isn't democracy. And one of the things that I've done when I've gone around, because I've been asked to talk to people who want to become organizers, and they ask me, well, why do people become organizers? And I say, because they've gotten screwed. And in the process of getting screwed, they realize that the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, which oversees reactors, they realize that the EPA, which oversees water and contamination, and their local government as well as state governments, cannot act to protect them. And what winds up happening is that people realize that they're in a fight for their lives and that the only one that will protect them is themselves and their own community. That's what began Citizens Awareness Network. And I remember I went to the Nuclear Regulatory Commission's, at that point, went to the library because that was the only way you could get information on your local nuke. And I looked up what they had been dumping in the river since this guy, the chemist, talked about it. And I found out that in one month, because at that point you could get monthly reports, now you can only get them every 18 months. Access to information, as the ability to use computers has actually decreased the ability to get relevant information. It said that they had dumped 1,200 curies of tritium into the river. And I did the calculations, you know, because they were complicated. And I said, 1,200, that couldn't be right. And I actually went downstairs and I called NIRS. You weren't even with CAN at that point. And I spoke to Paul Gunther and I said, I can't be right. I must be out of my mind. They couldn't be dumping 1,200 curies of tritium into the Deerfield River, which is a river that our kids swim in, which is adjacent to our schools, which farmland is adjacent to. This could not be happening. And he said, your calculations are right. And it was shocking. It was this moment of terror and awakening that there was nobody going to fight for us except us, and that they were poisoning our community. And that really began CAN. It was a bunch of women who got all the effluent, they're called effluent reports. All they mean is the amount of shit that Yankee Atomic dumped in the river. You know, there are all these terms you have to know, but basically it's the contamination that they are legally allowed to dump. It's not that Yankee Atomic did something scandalous and terrible for which they'd get fined. They were allowed to do this. This is perfectly okay. So what one other context I need to put this in, and then I'll stop driving you crazy with how terrible nuclear power is, because by the time I stop talking, everyone wants to go get a drink, including me, you know, because it's so terrible. And I don't want to leave us in that state because, you know, we might as well then become alcoholics or end it. So we had in our community, and at this point, as we were mobilizing around shutting Yankee Atomics Row Reactor, which we did shut, a group of women came to us and said, look, I have a kid with Down syndrome. My friend has a kid with Down syndrome. We have higher rates of Down syndrome in our community, and we need your help getting the Massachusetts Department of Health to actually look at this, because they keep telling us nothing is happening. And can actually mobilize the Massachusetts Department of Health to come. We were involved in a citizen advisory committee with them on health for 8 years, in which there was an acknowledgement that there was statistical significance in different kinds of cancers and statistical significance in Down syndrome. You have to understand the context for this, because in our valley, there are 7,000 people. To get statistical significance in anything, which is the scientific sense that there's real proof that somebody has gotten screwed, that's what it means. We give you a certification that you've gotten screwed. It involves large segments of the population. So to have a valley in which there was these kind of exploding statistics meant that we were suffering from an epidemic of disease. And why I raise that is because that's what CAN fights from. That's why we're doing it. We in our community have people empty from every one of our kitchen tables every night when we serve dinner. And we fight for all of those who are lost and who we may lose. At the same time, we have to recognize that people act from opportunism, right? So we came to understand, because we went to Connecticut and we worked to shut Connecticut Yankee and Millstone, but we also realized when we took on Vermont Yankee that much of the population in Vermont would not give a rat's ass if Western Massachusetts and Southern Vermont went down the tubes. And in a certain way, what we learned was we had to see the issue of organizing in a very different way, that we had to work not with people who were just like us, who hated nuclear power, and we didn't need to fight with people who were fanatically pro-nuclear, that what we had to be willing to do and work on was to move the middle. The ordinary people who didn't really know where they stood. They were concerned about things, but they got the power. Maybe it still was too cheap to meter. I don't know. I'm not a rocket scientist. I always said that if Nancy Reagan could say no to drugs, then anyone can say no to nuclear. It's just about the same thing. You can have your own opinion. So what we had to do was devise a campaign that really moved the middle in Vermont. And we did it legislatively, and we did it in many different ways. But it was not based just on how terrible the nuke is. Because as I started talking about my terrible story, which was very poignant, very real, but by the end of it, nobody wanted to hear one more thing I had to say, including me. Right? So we had to give people a sense of why it was important to them, why Montpelier should give a rat's ass about Vermont closing, especially since they were getting perks from Entergy, of course, as they always do. Mm-hmm. So that the issue was giving them something worth fighting for, which was a green energy future. We devised a campaign that said Vermont Yankee, with its relicensing, was an obstruction. It was going to block the development of a green community. It was going to block sustainable energy from being a reality, and that this fight was a fight that not just for us, but for our children, for a clean energy future, for climate change, for all of these issues. And that was something that could move people in a positive way. And then we had to work, because nobody believed that they could do it. Everyone, you know, just feels they have no power. What the hell? I'll watch Fox News and forget about it, right? And so we had to go through this thing of, I was going around Vermont saying, look guys, I suffer from radiation without representation. I live right across the border and I can't vote on this. I can't vote, but you can. You can make democracy work. And this campaign was a campaign for democracy. It was a campaign for the people. It was a sense that it was possible for people to change the course of history. And they did. And we did. So, why am I here at this moment at this table? Because we now have another fight on our hands. This is, in fact, the issue of moving the West and central Massachusetts about Pilgrim. Now, the truth is, people in Western Massachusetts, and I'm sorry, Diane, they don't give a flying fuck, to tell you the truth. They don't. About whether you are going to survive or not, whether you get off Cape Cod, they don't want to know about it. They don't want to feel bad. And I understand that very well. So I believe our job in the West, although there are issues that will come up, is really to move people on the issues that, in fact, Claire is raising, and in certain ways that Tim is raising, because the reality is that Entergy is a sinking ship. It is losing money and bleeding. It is what caused Vermont to close. But it closed because we cut off every avenue, basically, of an economic stream that could keep them going. And so the work in terms of taking Entergy on in Massachusetts is to cut off the economic streams or make it more and more financially, you know, impossible for them to operate. And those are things we have to work on. At the same time, we have to make it clear to people that Pilgrim is an obstruction for this energy revolution, that net metering won't be raised, that all of this will not happen as long as they can justify, and they attempt to justify, that Pilgrim's power is needed. And of course, Entergy's trying to get subsidies because it's above market rates at this point, can't compete with gas, can't even be competing with renewables. And we're not for fracking, and we bless the people who are working on fracking issues at this point. They're not ours, but we think it's essential. But what we have to do is create a revolution in energy policy in which we really see a sustainable future as possible. And our work in working on this is to bring the West and the East together, where we can meet in certain ways in the center of this state to actually create this energy revolution. So everyone that's here, I want you to join us. As I've said in Vermont, I can't promise you we'll win, but I can promise you it'll be a really exciting ride.
And it has been. It's taken a long time to defeat the Vermont Yankee plant. Many of us have been on this for many, many years before that. Since 1974, with a proposed plant for Montague, Massachusetts, it was fought and defeated before it even got started. Many of us were veterans of the Seabrook debacle and spent time in jail and other unpleasantries. So it's been a long, hard fight for the awareness of the dangers of nuclear power. Deb, did I cut you off, or were you finished with your diatribe?
I'm sure I had reached the point where I was going to start driving people crazy. So okay. It's fun.
Well, we'd like you at this time to invite any of those who have a question or a query of some sort or a concern to come up. To come up to the microphone here and state it to the panel. Event today is being videotaped, as I said before, by Michael Hainish of Free Lunch Films and the GCTV staff, and will be distributed on many community television stations throughout the states of Vermont and Massachusetts. So please come forward with your questions and concerns. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Gary Pontelandolfo. I'm on the board of CAN also. I'd just like to make a comment. I'm sorry, I got here late and I didn't get your name, woman from the Cape.
Arlene Williamson.
Oh, okay.
Pilgrim Coalition.
Diane Turco.
Yeah, it's nice to meet you all. But I'd like to just call a point. You made a distinction that you were making, like, to your elected representatives, that you weren't just nuclear activists, you were informed citizens. I've never met a nuclear activist who isn't an informed citizen. And I just ask you in the future not to make that comparison in a way that allows people to buy into the stereotype of anti-nuclear activists as just nutty people. Or uninformed.
We've had to fight that issue too. And until the governor wrote that letter that the people voted for, people, yeah, we were kind of like brushed aside by emergency people. Now they're all on board. Yeah, so.
So I mean,
I
say
take that. I will take
very
that.
Respectfully, okay. And I really appreciate you being here and all that you're doing. One way that I see to expand the geographic area of concerned citizens. Away from just residents of the Cape is vacation people. I mean, I live in Northwest Connecticut. I love going to the Cape. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't stop going because I knew about how dangerous it was in a case of an accident, but I sure would get probably more likely to be active or at least spread the word that there's problems if you target that vacation population. I don't know
how much you've done that. Sure, I mean, there's a lot of absentee people that just have beautiful summer homes. And have a vested...
Or even the people who just come for a week or a weekend.
Right.
So anyway, that's my suggestion.
Great. Right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I just want to say that can be kind of complicated, Gary. On the July 4th weekend around Roe, we put up signs that... the NRC was allowing Yankee Atomic to dump 60 curies of, I think it was cobalt 60 at the time, into the local river. And we put the signs up, Harvey was one of the people who put the signs up with us, all along the river. And of course, everyone's whitewater rafting on July 4th. Mm. And every local health department from each town was getting calls with people in a panic about what was in the river, and actually we had to go to a number of towns and talk to them and make nice in terms of...
Well, we do that on Cape Cod as well. Bill Maher is very instrumental in setting up protests on the bridges during Memorial Day and Labor Day weekends, where thousands of hundreds of thousands of people are exiting Cape Cod, who are visitors, basically. And we have signs, we have people in hazmat suits, we have no more Fukushimas. I mean, we try to make a big statement.
And it's been covered by the Boston News.
So that's a good way to hit those vacationers.
Yes, my name is Elaine Dickinson, and I live on Cape Cod. I'm part of the Cape Downwinders and Mass Downwinders, and I've been participant in those actions on the bridge as people come for the summer and Memorial Day, and when they leave and September at Labor Day. And it used to be, you know, we'd get people angry at us for causing the traffic jam and da-da-da-da-da and, you know, thumbs down and what's a Fukushima? But in the last few times that we've done it, we get lots of honks and thumbs up and thank you. Mm-hmm. They're not blaming us for the traffic jam anymore. Anyway, Tim, you mentioned some comparison between the Fukushima plant and the Pilgrim plant, which we're very much aware of. And you mentioned how it would be worse at Pilgrim than Fukushima, actually, because of some of the geological seismic things. But also, it was presented at one of the forums we had at the State House. I don't know if it was Gregory Yazko who said it, but they were comparing the spent fuel rods that are in the pool at Pilgrim compared with what was already removed in Fukushima and put in the casks. Those stayed intact, whereas what is in the spent fuel pool at the Pilgrim Nuclear Power Station is a tremendous number. It was built for 880. There's over 3,200 there. And that it would be a bigger disaster. You didn't mention that.
I didn't, but I mean, it's worth talking about. Yes, and, you know, I think that in terms of the reactor itself at Pilgrim is, you know, exactly the same design as the ones that blew up at Fukushima and has the same design flaws that contributed to that event being as bad as it was. What's worse at Pilgrim is, you know, is the issue of the spent fuel pool, and you know, the fuel pools, you know, at the fuel pools of Fukushima. were racked, you know, the fuels, the volume of radioactive waste in those pools was much lower than what's, you know, typical at almost every reactor in the U.S. And so I think as I think Diane mentioned, you know, the pool, the reactor Pilgrim was originally designed to hold like 880 fuel assemblies back when it was built in, you know, in 1972. You know, it now currently holds over 3,200 fuel assemblies. And so what's happened is that the Nuclear Regulatory Commission has allowed Pilgrim and reactors all across the country, virtually all of them, to pack the fuel more and more densely into these pools to the point where, you know, the fuel pools are packed as densely as the reactor cores themselves at this point, but with, you know, five or six times as much of much nuclear waste in them as what's contained in the reactor. So at Fukushima, the reason that the U.S. advised Americans within 50 miles of Fukushima to evacuate was because they were concerned about the fuel pool at the Unit 4 reactor becoming uncovered and there being one of these fuel pool accidents. But the amount of fuel in that pool at Unit 4 at Fukushima is probably, you know, a third to a quarter of the amount of fuel that's in the pool at Pilgrim right now.
Right.
And you know, that fuel pool accident didn't happen at Unit 4 at Fukushima, but I think had it been the similar conditions with the Pilgrim reactor, the water in that pool would have boiled off much more quickly, would have become exposed much more quickly, and even the extra amount of hundreds of tons of waste that's sitting in that fuel pool, as structurally damaged as the building at Unit 4 Fukushima was, you know, the extra weight in that pool at the top of the building could have actually, you know, resulted in, you know, many scenarios where a much worse accident could have happened. So I think from that standpoint, yes, I mean, obviously, you know, from that, the biggest difference in terms of danger with Pilgrim versus Fukushima is the fuel pool.
Okay, thank you for clarifying that.
Something like 100 tons at Fukushima, between 80 and 100 tons is what they talked about. And at Vermont Yankee, there are 530 tons. And I'm sure Pilgrim is somewhere close to that. And that's the part of the difference in terms of what Tim's talking about.
And if I could just follow up, too, is in 2008, a study was completed by the Attorney General's office, and it was determined if there was a spent fuel pool accident there, we're sitting in Greenfield right now. That study said that hundreds of miles would become contaminated. That includes Greenfield. That includes Massachusetts, right. Rhode Island, Connecticut, New Hampshire, Maine, Vermont, hundreds of miles. So it's a serious issue. And a Nuclear Regulatory Commission staff person told me at one of those NRC dog and pony shows, I said, Bill was with me. Could Fukushima happen here? And he said, absolutely. Mm-hmm. And if anyone tells you otherwise, they're lying. We have that on tape.
He said that 2 years in a row.
Yes.
Radioactive waste in it. Water needs to be circulating constantly.
Yeah.
And there are four stories up in the air.
Seven.
The top of the building with no shielding for the radiation.
If I could make one other comment and then hear your comments on that. From what we understand in Cape Downwinders, the percentage of power that goes on the grid that's produced at the Pilgrim reactor is 2%.
For ISO New England.
You mean it's
2%
of the grid?
It's 2% of ISO New England. So, yeah.
Now, what does that mean?
Of the generation capacity, it represents 2%. So, ISO New England is Maine, New Hampshire, Vermont, Massachusetts, Connecticut, and Rhode Island.
Independent system
operator
right.
of New England.
Yeah. So,
Massachusetts. They manage the grid.
So 2%
of the total,
Massachusetts
is made represents approximately half. So you could say it's about 1% of Massachusetts' load.
All right. So the obvious question is
why?
Why put so many people at such risk for so little
no
power,
risk.
And they're subsidized by our government through
May
our tax money?
It's safe. Clean,
the military industrial complex.
Meter. This is the propaganda that was sold that created these plants 40 something years
ago.
Well,
in 1953, Eisenhower had a choice to either do nuclear or solar.
Oh, wow. We know which way he went. Jimmy Carter had solar panels on the White House. Yeah. Reagan ripped them off.
And those solar panels that were developed in the 1950s are still generating electricity today.
Wow.
Not very much, but they are still generating electricity.
Well, thank everyone on the panel. Very informative.
Thank you.
I mean, I think what I would say in response to the question of why is that, I mean, as Deb mentioned, Massachusetts and the rest of the New England states, 15 years ago, deregulated the utilities. Okay. They forced the utility companies, Boston Edison, which used to own Pilgrim, the Vermont, and the other New England utilities that own Vermont Yankee and, Northeast Utilities, which owns Millstone, they forced the utilities to sell off their power plants, to just become deliverers of electricity. And basically the regulators and the state governments in New England and in New York and elsewhere basically, sort of devolved, divested themselves of responsibility for what happens and how electricity is generated for the most part. Right. And so they brought in companies, they allowed companies like Entergy to come in that are very lightly regulated by the states to run these plants and essentially, on a for-profit basis. And so the reason that Pilgrim is still operating in a certain sense, is that Massachusetts gave away its right to say yes or no, the state government to say yes or no to this reactor continuing to operate 15 years ago.
They had a fantasy, I think. I mean, I would go further and say they eviscerated their rights because mm-hmm. I don't think they're, in fact, Vermont, which is not deregulated, is still struggling to have any control over Entergy. And Massachusetts, when we fought deregulation and, the public service department in Massachusetts was saying, we have a gun to our head. And I said, it's not going to be anything like the gun you're going to have to your head after you do this, because you'll have no power. And that's part of what Massachusetts will struggle with, and part of what a campaign to deal with Pilgrim will struggle with, which is who has the power to close that nuke. Mm-hmm. You see, it's a failing nuke. Mm-hmm. The issue is who is supporting it and who has the power and how. And that's very important to figure out in this, in terms of figuring out any campaign of East meets West, how we move forward, because it can be a waste of time to target someone who can't do anything in terms of closure, where we have to know who has that power and how. And it's going to have nothing to do with the NRC, because the NRC will never close a nuclear reactor. They're in the business of supporting them. They believe in safe nuclear, they don't even believe in safe nuclear power. They just believe in keeping every last nuke that's on the planet going, so that the issue is who in Massachusetts has the power and how can they be influenced. And that's part of the work we all need to do to figure out how to work on it. That's the work we did in Vermont, which was that the Public Service Board had power, the legislature had power, and the governor had power. And so we planned our targets based on who could make a decision on this. And we focused it, in fact, on the legislature as the way to do it.
But I guess what I would add to that, Deb, and I think that, we're sort of coming full circle in a lot of ways as the movement. But I think, we planned the campaign to close Vermont Yankee around these issues of democracy and around the state having the authority to say no to relicensing of the plant and the continued operation. And that campaign worked, but it also worked in unexpected ways, which was that we turned the entire political establishment as well as almost the entire population of Vermont against that plant. Right. And and in the process, cut off all of Entergy's opportunities to get contracts for its power to pay for itself. The state has took measures to actually increase the cost on the reactor by levying taxes and those sort of things. Mm-hmm. So what ended up closing Vermont Yankee was, in fact, the economics in the end.
But it was ours.
But we drove it. Yeah. But in a certain sense, that's not different than the way we've closed almost every other reactor in the country that's closed, which is before deregulation.
Right.
It was to force the NRC to actually regulate safety, to come in and make the companies address safety violations. Mm-hmm. And what would happen is that, you know, of course, you know, with plants like Millstone and Connecticut Yankee and Yankee Row, that the cost of getting back, you know, of addressing the safety violations that they'd allowed to build up over time because they so mismanaged the plants, you know, made it cost prohibitive for them to continue to operate even under, you know, when they were owned by the utilities and could get their costs covered, that the utility commissions were saying, no way, we're not going to pay for you to invest hundreds and more millions of dollars in these plants. We're in the same position now again. Right. It's, you know, that economics are what's going to close a lot of these plants. It's just that we're having to work on it in a different way. Right. And, you know, and their costs are going up all by themselves right now because these reactors are getting so old. No. But, you know, but now we have to use different ways to put the economic pressure on these plants. And, you know, and to enable the states to make the right decision about where our energy is going to come from.
Agreed.
Hi, I'm Gary Sachs from Brattleboro. And when I hear all this talk about Pilgrim, I also simultaneously think about Fitzpatrick. Six of one, half the other. They're both Entergy nukes. They're both teetering on the edge. They're both too expensive. They're both boiling water reactors. They're ..
Gary, can you say what Fitzpatrick is?
Fitzpatrick is a nuclear reactor outside of Oswego, New York.
Also owned by Entergy.
We could include Indian Point on that.
That's a bigger one, and that's pressurized.
But it's not a boiling water. Fitzpatrick is the other BW. Exactly.
It's owned by Entergy. As a question to you guys, I would ask how much of the 1,500 megawatt I don't know if it's TDI. What's the company that's dropping the 1,500 megawatt cable under Lake Champlain? Is that due to go down to Westchester to serve as replacement energy?
Well, there are two different cables going.
Good.
One is going under Lake Champlain and going to Boston, and that's going to use Hydro-Quebec's energy ostensibly. That's a deal that is almost in place. And then the other one is actually going down ostensibly to New York and has the ability, in fact, to undermine Fitzpatrick and potential, I don't know if it,
IP.
Or to undermine Indian Point.
I think to Gary's question, so there's, as Deb mentioned, there's the power line project, you know, coming into New England that's, you know, that's ostensibly to deliver power from hydropower from Hydro-Quebec in Canada. The governor of New York has also, you know, pushed for there to be projects like the same power line that's going to come down the Hudson Valley to, you know, connecting to Quebec as part of, you know, a strategy to, you know, to help, you know, prepare for the closure of the Indian Point nuclear power plant in downstate New York and to deliver 1,000 megawatts more electricity to downstate New York through that way. So that's, I think, kind of, you know, that's one of the options that's on the table for, you know, for enabling the, you know, the Indian Point reactors to close.
But not the TDI that's coming down into Westchester. There is one coming down. There's one that was supposed to go over to Lake Champlain. That one got, phase two got canceled.
I'm sure we're talking about the same thing.
Right. Okay, I'm not sure, and I just want to make, I'd like to know, and I don't hear that it's being used as replacement.
Yeah. Yeah.
It is or it's not?
The governor of New York has done two things to help address a number of energy problems in New York, and one of them is called New York State Energy Highway, which is sort of some bigger picture transmission projects, you know, including this one coming down the Hudson River.
Yep.
And there's also what he's called the Indian Point Reliability Contingency Plan, which is to some specific projects to address, you know, to make sure that when Indian Point shuts down, which could be as soon as in a year or two, that the local grid is going to be stable in order, you know, and be able to, you know, that more power can come in. And these things are all sort of connected in different ways. But
the one that's coming down that will go to Boston is not ostensibly going to affect Pilgrim.
The other thing I would say, I really appreciate being here because you guys aren't lying to me. I don't like being lied to. Entergy has a habit of lying to me.
Question whether we were lying to you. I didn't have some kind of lie detector here, so you could know we were.
I was checking your notes, Deb. There were no lies. And but I am starting a TV show because I think that part of it is calling them on their lies as a way to stop them from the public perspective. The more anybody can say that's not true and elaborate why it's not true, the more it calls into question their veracity, which is good to undermine.
Mm-hmm. Well, thanks. They started a TV show.
I know.
And so that's now the one, you need one.
That's why I'm responding to it, because they're lying to us using that TV show.
Good.
In the first show, I heard them call interim spent fuel storage installations long-term storage.
Well, that's it's sort of true.
Yeah, that's actually not completely untrue.
True, yes.
I mean, it's now...
Yep.
Well, no, it's actually the official policy of the Nuclear Regulatory Commission right now is that these dry cast storage facilities at reactor sites, you know, could and may, and the NRC says, you know, or would be perfectly fine if they did become, long-term storage sites for spent nuclear fuel. And, you know, this is completely absurd and ridiculous. But this is, you know, sort of essentially where, the nuclear establishment in the country has gone to, is that in order to justify the continued generation of nuclear waste, even while we have no solution to what to do with nuclear waste, and that what's being done with it now could be done forever.
Is there?
Are you still? Well, how did you get back up here, Carrie? I thought there was a young woman.
There was transportation.
To be able to speak.
You didn't see the escalator.
Is this a revolving door policy?
Yes, ma'am. So, the my question to Tim is 30 to 50 years from now, is there a system designed, when there's no spent fuel pool, to swap out casks?
No, the answer is no.
No,
they don't
know
how to do it.
No. No, there is.
You might have answered yes, and I would have been glad.
Yeah. I would defer to Gary any day. He's much more knowledgeable than I am on this matter. Hi, I'm Lori Cartwright. I'm from Brattleboro, and I was very pleased to hear that there's work being done already in anticipation of the decommissioning of Pilgrim, because I know in my heart that it's just a very short matter of time before, I'm not sure exactly what will happen, but there will be a shift, and the people who are in a position to close Pilgrim will make that right decision. So I'm very grateful to hear that there's already people thinking and doing work with an eye towards decommissioning, because in Vermont, what we're dealing with is a victory on the one hand that Vermont Yankee is no longer operating, but the very real dangers of the spent fuel in the pool that's overcrowded, and all of those dangers. The emergency planning zone is going to be reduced to the fence line in April. This coming April 2016, and we're dealing with a lot of issues still, and I think that what happens with the general population is that they feel that the plant is not operating. Again, it's a victory, but they don't realize that we're still facing many dangers on a daily basis that are possibly greater than the dangers we were facing when the plant was operating, because of the spent fuel's vulnerability. It's not, the radiation isn't contained, it's not in a containment building, it's essentially in a spent fuel.
It's safer than the operating of a Mark I reactor. The fuel pool is not safe, it's absolutely true, but the truth is it is safer with Vermont Yankee closed than operating. And it needs to be acknowledged that way, because even though this is a transition and they have crappy plants, you're absolutely right, and they are not dealing with this very well, we are in a much better position at this moment than we were before January.
Okay, I'm glad, and I'm sorry for that misstatement.
It's okay, but I just want to relieve you, actually.
I'm relieved,
you can
and
feel
I don't
better.
I don't want to misstate anything, and I do just want to, again, reiterate that it is important work to be doing before you're faced with the decommissioning than after, because, again, I know that it's going to close soon. The last thing I want to say, and I don't know if this is a timed thing, but I want to say that I know Seabrook is in New Hampshire. It's not in Massachusetts, but I do know that many, many, many people living in Massachusetts are within the emergency planning zone of Seabrook. So I feel like my friends and patriots in Massachusetts almost have a double whammy that they're facing. So I hope that there's energy, time, and resources to devote to also keeping that in people's minds and hopefully in their actions.
Yes. Yeah, yes. Some of the legislation is combined for the South Shore and Cape Cod is were sort of co-written by representatives from who are looking out for those people.
Okay, right. Excellent.
In expanding EPZ zones.
Excellent. Yeah. And I had the pleasure of walking with some of the folks from Massachusetts Downwinders and other organizations recently from Plymouth to Boston, and it was really wonderful to meet them, and I really am glad to see that they're doing that level of awareness. And I probably should have started off by saying that I am involved with the New England Coalition on Nuclear Pollution. So I often don't mention that because I am speaking as a concerned citizen. I'm not speaking as any sort of representative from any sort of organization. I'm speaking from my heart as a citizen, a mother.
Sure.
So in the interest of full disclosure, I'm affiliated with that group and very proud to be affiliated with that
They've
group.
They've done a lot of great work. They're really terrific. And one of the things we are planning to do is, as we're starting to work together, we want to start having probably meetings every 2 or 3 months, but where it becomes more regional, where we bring in Seabrook and Millstone and we start having regional meetings about how we can work together on these issues.
I think that that is the best idea I've heard in a long time because we're all committed to the same goal, and that's a nuclear-free existence. So I think that putting all of our minds and energy together is really a wonderful idea, and thank you. I look forward to assisting and working with those processes.
Thank you.
It must be emphasized that groups such as CAN and various other groups in Vermont are still working with the state to correct some of the bad decisions that have been made by the NRC and Entergy Corporation through the court system, perhaps in the future. So this the end game hasn't been realized yet.
In terms of decommissioning.
In terms of, yes, I'm referring to the decommissioning question, of course. You know, it's been ludicrous at many of the meetings that I've been at to see that Entergy is projecting that the final cleanup of the site and using of the site will not be until almost 70 years down the road, in which all of those commissioners on the NRC will be long dead and buried for the most part. So this timeline, I don't think is finite at this point, or, you know, infinite, I should say, at this point. So there is still a lot of communication going on between various groups and the state of Vermont to perhaps address some of these problems, as this woman has brought up.
Hi, my name is Bill Morrow. I'm a member of the Cape Downwinders. It's great to be here. Great to hear everybody. I have a question for Tim, and it has to do with decommissioning and the legacy waste. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I've been a big proponent of dry cask storage since, it's safer than being in the pool. It's on the ground, and, you know, it's a passive system. It's not an active system. But, it occurs to me that this may not be a reversible process. Mm-hmm. You put it in this can, and these cans aren't going to last forever. Mm-hmm. You know, they're saying 100 years. They're saying the waste could be on site for 300 years. The plant's going to sit in safe store for 60. Basically, everybody's just kicking the can down the road and going to see how it plays out. Once you move it into the dry cast storage, is it a reversible process? Once that can wears out, can they take it out and put it in a bigger can, or are they just going to keep encasing it in a bigger can? How's that going to go?
Sure. This is a real problem. And, you know, and in fact, the industry doesn't have a solution to it at this point. The manufacturers of these dry cask storage systems that are in use in the U.S. have been asked this on a number of occasions recently, and that's in part because there have been some, you know, pretty significant design flaws that have come out with respect to the current versions of dry casks that are being used that show that they could wear out much quicker than the industry has represented. And so when industry officials have, you know, these, you know, the, you know, officials of these companies, including one who just spoke at the Vermont Holtec that just spoke in Vermont a couple months ago, is that they would basically, you know, sort of use a Russian doll system of, you know, putting one, you know, the failed cask inside of another cask. Mm-hmm. We need a more systematic solution to this. And in fact, what we've supported for a long time, and in fact, you know, CAN and NEARS and hundreds of other organizations across the country have promoted, for the last, 12, 13 years, is a really more comprehensive, approach to this situation, which we've called hardened on-site storage, which is both necessary, to address the vulnerability of these casks to both to natural disasters and to acts of terrorism and sabotage, but that involves, really taking a wholesale new look at dry cask storage. And there are much better ways of doing dry cask storage than what are currently done in the U.S. And I think that Europe is a place where some of that has been taken into account. They use a much different type of canister than what we use in the U.S., one in which isn't just welded shut and is, that actually, can be, it's called monitored retrievable dry cask storage, where they can actually, monitor the cask and be able to access the waste again if there's a problem with the cask. But I think, what we're not just sort of accepting that we just go and use European dry casks. We need to have a much more comprehensive approach to the problem of how you store waste at reactor sites in a way that's going to actually be safer for the community, given that, it in all likelihood is going to be decades that this waste is going to be sitting at reactor sites, because the U.S., the process and the policy for finding a long-term management method for nuclear waste in the U.S. is completely broken at this point. And we're decades away from actually having a viable storage solution in place. And the only reasonable thing to do for the time being is to keep the waste where it's at, but it's got to be done much safer than it's being done. And certainly getting the waste out of the pool is the first and most necessary step. But we need a more comprehensive solution to that as well.
There are no good solutions to nuclear power. There are only better and worse ones. And dry cask storage is better than a pool suspended seven stories in the air. It's also that this is all very idiosyncratic for each nuclear site. So CAN has supported and helped come up with the notion of hardened on-site storage, which involves overpacks. It protects it from terrorism. There are a lot of issues. Mm-hmm. It could never fly at Vermont Yankee because there are only 100 acres on the site. So each site as well has different issues. At Vermont Yankee, what we want is a berm around the whole fuel site, that whole area, so that the potential for terrorism to take place is really limited. At Pilgrim, it's a much bigger site. Mm-hmm. Yankee Row had 2,000 acres to it. So each site is very idiosyncratic in this, and each site has to be dealt with that way. What we are saying, and I want to make this clear, is we do not believe that waste should move until there's an environmentally just and scientifically sound solution to this problem, which does not exist. At this point, it needs to be pointed out that in Texas, they are trying to move to set up a kind of interim storage for high-level waste.
A parking lot
for it, as if a parking lot is possible with high-level waste. When they tried to set up a parking lot out in Utah with the Goshute tribe, when Boston Edison was asked, and they were the owner of Pilgrim at that point, what happens if you have a leaky cask out in Utah? And what they said to the NRC is, well, we just ship it back. Uh-huh. We just ship it back. We actually went into a lawsuit against them shipping their waste at that point because this was really insane. And we won that lawsuit against them. But There are environmental issues of racism and justice involved in all of this. Mm-hmm. Besides the scientific issues, the communities chosen for nuclear contamination are poor, rural, First Nation, mm-hmm. Native American, mm-hmm. people of color communities, and there is a way that many of the communities around nukes are white, varying in privilege. The communities in Vermont and you know, at Roe were poor, but the industry has worked assiduously to create a conflict between reactor sites and dump sites over who gets screwed last, where reactor sites will accept the notion of dumping on someone else. Mm-hmm. And I just want to make it clear that CAN really takes this position that is unacceptable, mm-hmm. that we can't use someone else for, you know, our toilet. When we took Caravan of Conscience tours down to South Carolina, which is where Roe's waste went, in the mm-hmm. local papers, Yankee Roe in Massachusetts was seen as a carpetbagger. Mm-hmm. And South Carolina was seen as a toilet mm-hmm. for Massachusetts waste. Mm-hmm. And the community that was chosen for the waste from Yankee Row was 47% African American, poor, rural. It was an incredibly painful and excruciating experience going down to that community and seeing who had been chosen for mm-hmm. sacrifice, as my community mm-hmm. in Roe had been chosen for mm-hmm. sacrifice, as Pilgrim right. had been chosen for sacrifice, as Vernon and the towns around were chosen for sacrifice. Mm-hmm. There are ethical issues to this mm-hmm. that actually make the issue of what to deal with this waste far more complicated and much broader in terms of equity and justice. So I have to finally get that out there in some form where people take that in, because there are legacy issues to this nightmare that are not resolved by just sending waste to Texas or Utah or anywhere else. And I'm sorry. I wish I could say, hey, we just dump it somewhere else. You're right. We just get it out of here and it's cool. But they have created a diabolical nightmare, and we are all caught in it, and there is no easy way through, and I'm sorry it'll make everyone want to drink. I'm sorry, I went too far.
That's all right. It's not just an American indigenous.
I'm sorry.
You gotta
say it.
I would just like to add that this is not just a uniquely American situation. Europe has been mentioned, and one of the greatest nuclear countries in Europe is France. And France has been noted to, in its former colonies, which many of them were in the Sahara regions and the Sahel regions of North Africa, where I spend an awful lot of time, it too is poor and usually black has a vast, vast area in which to dispose of nuclear waste. And it has been used so. One of the controversies off the coast of Somalia, for example, which probably started the piracy episodes there, were that French ships and European ships were dumping nuclear waste off the coast of Somalia. And the fishermen were really PO'd about it. And this, of course, doesn't make the mainstream press in the United States, and will never will. So just wanted to add that.
My name is Susan Carpenter. I live on the Cape, and I'm a member of Cape Downwinders and Mass Downwinders. I have a question for Claire. You asked for our help with the bill before the governor. Is this a bill that has come out of committee and is on?
So the governor proposed this legislation on Thursday. The legislature recessed on July 31st. Mm-hmm. Will not reconvene until September. They're on recess right now. So that bill will be, it'll probably go before the TUE, the Telecommunications, Utilities, and Energy Joint Committee between the House and the Senate first. There are a number of bills in both the Senate and the House side that are good bills. One is the Coulter Mark Aldridge bill, which the House number is H2852. I can't remember the Senate number. There are a number of other bills that are also good that address renewable energy, net metering, climate change.
Claire, if you get those to me, I will get them out to Diane, who can get them out to her people.
There is also a website that I want to mention, which is called Solar is Working. org, no punctuation. It was put together by a group of coalition of environmental, labor, and solar industry folks, and we became basically Mass Solar. And we, you can check the web, there are a number of resources on there. Anytime there's some action or something that we need people to do, it'll get posted on there. There also, CAN has an action alert list. Mm-hmm. I have one also that I send out information for folks mm-hmm. on some irregular basis.
So the governor's bill does not have a number
nope.
yet?
No. Nope.
Okay, that's what I
yep. check.
Thank you.
Breaking news, you got it here.
Hi, I'm Pat Berry, and I don't know if anyone was there a year and a half ago. Gary and I went down to Duxbury, and I believe it was a coalition. It was about, were you there?
Right, at the senior
okay. Yeah. And the thing that they had said at the time, and if you would just expand on it, what they're doing with the spent from Plymouth. The spent fuel and how they're going to store it, and that the ground is unstable and it's all going to erode into the ocean. And they were trying to work on something to do with it. That's one thing. The other thing is they had said about the finances that our federal government was actually keeping that alive. They could not do it. They were not economically feasible. And at the time, because I have worked and I have been effective in things like this. In fact, we tried to stop nuclear from ever being. My heart's broken that we weren't effective. We wouldn't be in this place we are now. People didn't care. They were apathetic. Who cares? We're going to get cheap electricity. And we went all over trying to stop it. But anyway, I had asked, why can't we go after the finance? If our federal government is keeping them alive, why can't we go after this? And you can be effective. I was called a silly little girl. I wanted to get up and strangle her because it wouldn't have helped, but she was totally wrong. You can get them in the pocketbook, and you brought it up. So those two things, is there anything more on the finance, and is there anything more about keeping that as the site for all the spent? I don't know what it is. I really, you know.
Spent fuel.
Yeah. That they're going to keep on the ocean?
Yeah, I'll do the spent fuel.
You could do the other one.
The
great. Okay, the problem with the spent fuel pool is actually, this gentleman right here, Bill Maher, was very instrumental in spying where this cask storage pad was being built. Mm-hmm. And we were able to take photographs of it, and that's when everybody questioned, why are they putting this spent fuel pool at just above sea level, so close to the shoreline, with all that's happening with climate change and all of that stuff? So we spearheaded a task force, actually, headed by two attorneys who insisted that Plymouth imply a need for them to go before the zoning commission or the zoning committee and ask for a special permit. You know, people build a deck on their house, they have to get a special building permit. Here we're talking about a nuclear storage facility that's going to be built just under the rug. They went and talked, I guess, to someone who said, no, you don't need a special permit. And it went before the Zoning Board of Appeals, and it came down to a very close vote. No, they don't need a special zoning permit. So it was appealed. It's in the court systems right now, and it's making a lot of progress. They did have some successful. Bill, do you know what happened the other day, if you want to comment on that? I know they got some good ruling the other day.
Yeah, just last week, I think they had a hearing in Boston in the land court. It's being challenged in the land court. The Zoning Board of Appeals decision not to require a special permit is being challenged, and the judge seems to be very sympathetic. Entergy's lawyers wanted to separate the case into two separate cases. He said, no, we're keeping it all together. And the whole idea behind this is they started building this without any permits at all. Somebody flew over, took some pictures. I've been in the construction business. I saw a pile driver in the picture. I said, hey, they're doing something there. Checked to see if there are permits. They didn't have any building permits. Nothing. Nothing. This is a nuclear waste dump site. If you don't have a building permit, how about a special permit? this is not a standard use of the property. So it's just amazing. It's arrogant, mm-hmm. and it's sneaky, mm-hmm. and it was intentional. This was not, I made a mistake. Oops. No, this was by design.
They did the same thing at Vermont Yankee in terms of starting this work, in terms of moving soil around without getting permits or pulling for it. You might want to check into what happened in Connecticut, because I think the town also took up on, the Yankee site, Connecticut Yankee, and what happened there, because I think the town kicked up a fuss about the issue of them not pulling a permit and having similar issues. You might want to see what happened with that case that went through the Connecticut courts as well.
After they did pull the permits, they petitioned the permits. They pulled a permit for a foundation. They pulled a permit for a chain link fence. They pulled a permit for a retaining wall. What they really needed was a permit for a nuclear waste dump site.
Right, and
which would require public hearings. It would also require an environmental assessment.
Right.
And they got to sidestep all of that because the building inspector, who enforces the building code, really looked the other way. So,
question for that. I mean, has the town looked into, or whoever's doing the lawsuit looked into, how this intersects with the NRC's official sort of, continued storage waste policy?
I'm sure they have. Meg Sheehan is the lead lawyer. Mary Lampert's husband, Jim Lampert, is also involved in it. And there's two or three other lawyers there.
Because the issue that the NRC, so the NRC for decades had a policy which they called waste confidence, which was sort of one of the underpinnings of their licensing process for nuclear power plants. It was essentially a regulation that NRC said they don't need to consider the impact of nuclear waste storage or the generation of nuclear waste as an environmental impact when making decisions about whether to license a facility or to approve different licensing actions. And that was actually overthrown in the court about 3 years ago, challenging the very notion that, we don't have a nuclear waste, long-term storage program that's functioning in the country right now. This notion of having waste confidence is bogus. So the court forced the NRC to throw out that regulation. And what the NRC came back with is this continued storage rule that came out 2 years ago, and that was that was adopted last year, which, as I mentioned before, essentially is the NRC allowing itself to continue this process of licensing reactors without considering nuclear waste storage, on the premise that it's safe to store waste at these dry cask storage facilities at reactor sites for hundreds of years, essentially indefinitely. And the idea that, by placing this dry cask storage pad, at sea level at the Pilgrim site, mm-hmm. with sea level rise known to be, sort of advancing in the next 100 years, that's a violation of even NRC's absurd due policy. That they should be allowed to do that.
Yeah, in my conversations with the NRC about this, is they say they're not permitting them to store waste, but what they'll do is after the construction, they come in and give them a certificate of compliance, mm-hmm. that they have built it in compliance with the NRC's rules and regulations. And it's not at sea level, it's actually at 24.5 feet above sea level, and it is about 125 feet away from the shoreline.
Wow.
The velocity zone for storms is 18 feet. So you have a 6 foot, a little six foot play there. As long as you don't get a Hurricane Sandy or something like that.
That storage pad, there's elevated spots on their own property that it would have made more sense. And
basically they had to cut into the side of the hill to put it in and build a retaining wall. They could have gone 200 feet that way, they would have been 90 feet above sea level because it's a big hill. But this stuff moves slow when they move it on the ground, and that's a lot of concrete roads that you have to build. Mm-hmm. This is all about money.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
on right. the cheap. Right.
Mm. Yeah. Well, they also have to provide security.
Right.
The dry cast storage pad needs to be within a secure area, and so if they're gonna have to put the pad in a place that's far away from the reactor building, then they're gonna have to expand their security perimeter, which they've already had problems maintaining, even with the way that it's being done right now.
Right.
Well, I'd hate to bring this thing to a close, folks, but we have reached 1 o'clock in the afternoon, which was the cutoff date or cutoff time for our discussions here. I thought it's been very fruitful. The questions asked were very interesting. The responses were just as interesting. And I think that this has been a great first step in East meeting West and confronting our problems. Thank you all for coming.
Victory.
Victory.
And now go drink.